This week's hot topics. Capital idea. The name is announced for the country's new capital, so it looks like the move out of Jakarta is happening. TUBBY TOTS, how the pandemic has resulted in more fat kids, and why Dr. Melanie Iskandar says it needs to be fixed now. And high stakes, why more people are cutting up expensive beef. Hello, I'm Dalton Tanonak in Jakarta. Here are my co-hosts, Sandrina Malakiano, Deputy CEO of Polmark Indonesia from her home in South Tangerang, and Millie Lukito, CEO of the Mobiliari Group on the road in Vancouver, Canada. Hot topic number one, capital idea. President Joko Widodo made his latest decision this week. From more than 80 names, the country's new capital city will be called Nusantara, which means archipelago. This was the latest step in relocating the home of the central government to East Kalimantan, northeast of Java. Earlier this month, the design for the new presidential palace was made, featuring a mythical Garuda design. Now, it was before the COVID-19 pandemic hit in 2019 when the relocation plan was announced. And the reasons were congestion, pollution, and the city is sinking because of climate change. Sandrina, you know, I was skeptical at first, but I think things are moving along.
Dalton, in my position as Deputy CEO of Polmark Indonesia, I have had many discussions with the Minister of National Development Planning, head of Bappenas, or the National Development Planning Agency of Indonesia, Minister Suharto Monoarfa. President Jokowi appointed Minister Suharto Monoarfa as the chairman of the Indonesian Capital City Relocation Committee. This is how, since quite some time ago, I found out that President Jokowi and his government are really serious about this plan of relocating the capital city. And I believe that later at the end of his term, Jokowi wants to make this one of his important legacies. The relocation of our country's capital city has been a topic of discussion since President Sukarno's era, so about seven decades ago, Dalton. And I'm guessing President Jokowi wants to show to the world that it's during his presidency this discourse of relocating the capital city finally becomes a reality. So it no longer remains just a plan or topic of discussion. Now, our responsibility as citizens is to continuously and closely observe, keep a close eye on the relocation policies. We have to ensure that all the process are carried out properly and are based on the principles of public accountability and transparency. We must not forget that this capital city's relocation is a super big project. Therefore, its funding is of a gigantic scale, and we don't want to see the same mistakes we often find behind many other public policies.
Sure, yeah, big money projects, funding,
corruption,
also
collusion, nepotism,
the
policy,
land, the buyout of land around the new capital. You know, I would think they're bigger priorities, but anyway, that's what they're doing. Now, other countries have done this, separating government and business centers, like in the U.S., of course, and Myanmar, closer to home, although Myanmar's capital is now a ghost town. Millie, doesn't this actually hurt the public, the ones that government is meant to serve, because now they're far away? I mean, yeah, Jakarta is not the only city, but the bulk of the business and work is done here.
Well, in Canada, where I'm at the moment, they also have the government side, which is in Ottawa, and commercial and financial capital or cities are Toronto and Vancouver. And because of that, you can see a more fair wealth distribution. And I think I like that move, and I agree with our government to do the same. However, you know, when Canada or US, when they separate capital city and also financial cities, it was in the era before the internet. Now we are in the internet era where people can easily post their comment, their ideas about this freely. And I can already see a lot of controversy with the name Nusantara. So what I'm Such a pity, I think, that the government should be more in communication with the people in doing this and sharing with the people of the detail of the of this, like Sandrina said, a super huge project. Because I think it's a little bit done hastily, and a lot of people are actually doubting whether in the long run it can be successful.
And, you know, public officials now will, I guess, have to staff two offices to serve their constituents in Jakarta and East Kalimantan, costing more taxpayers' money. And politicians, I'm sure, will kind of get annoyed a bit because they have to travel back and forth between both cities. Who does this exactly benefit, Sandrina?
Oh, Dalton, of course, in the beginning, everyone will need to adapt to these changes and all the extra costs, the discomfort. But in time, these changes would be not too big a problem anymore. What I see is that in the future, Indonesia will become, for example, like Millie just said, Canada, or like the United States, where New York is the center of economy and business, while the center of government is in Washington, D.C., or closer to home, Malaysia, the country's capital city, as well as center of economy and business, is in Kuala Lumpur, while the center of government is in Putrajaya. Now, what needs to be the main focus here is the main reason behind the relocation. The argument used is because our capital city, Jakarta, no longer has the capacity to accommodate all the growth and development. In the future, climate change and all its effects will make things worse for Jakarta. Jakarta's ecological carrying capacity will continue to decrease, making it more uninhabitable, while Jakarta's population continues to grow. Now, so in this context, the government must ensure that all the problems and existing issues used as a reason to move the capital from Jakarta will not occur in the new capital city. For example, Jokowi guaranteed that the new capital city will be green and flood-free. But we have seen floods hit the area in Kutai Kartanegara, East Kalimantan, where the new capital city will be built. The city planning must be really good so the capital city, the new one, will not end up having the same problems. And to underline what Millie said, what's good from this is that development and prosperity will be dispersed in a more just way throughout the nation, so it's not no longer centered in Java alone.
Okay, now as we know, ladies, many policies and laws have been tried before and then struck down or disregarded. You know, I was really thinking that before the moving happened or the moving date came in 2024, leaders might say, maybe this isn't such a good idea, the public has a backlash, and then it wouldn't happen. Millie, is that a possibility?
No, I think by 2024, because by next year, the state budget will already reflect the cost, the additional cost and budget for the relocation. So all the politicians and then state-owned employees, for example, they will definitely follow the relocation. However, we also must know, the public has the right to know of the current government's sustainability plans, because Pak Jokowi will end his tenure in 2024, right at the relocation timing. So what will happen in 2030, 2040? Will this be sustainable in the future? Because there are many countries with a separation of government and financial centers where there are chaos and create more uncertainties. And this should not happen post-President Jokowi.
Yeah, you know, I was just thinking, in Jakarta, I'm looking along the Senayan area, other parts, you have these giant pillars for mass transit started 15 years ago, and they're still standing there like monuments to a failed project. So hopefully this isn't the case. Okay, Hot Indo will continue shortly with TUBBY, TOTS, why more kids than ever are overweight. Dr. Melanie Iskandar joins us with practical advice on this problem.
Oh, I feel good. I knew that I was- saya ingin mengumumkan kerjasama dengan The Indonesia Channel. Saya mendorong semua entitas untuk bergabung dalam upaya ini dengan mempromosikan produk dan layanan mereka di platform digital yang unik ini.
I love Indonesia. I love the food. Yummy.
Wow. I'm gonna hunt for ingredients. Now I'm ready to cook. Let's go to the kitchen.
It's done. Let's meet to eat.
Foodipedia on the Indonesia Channel.
Hello guys, nama saya Gali. Saya hobi touring. Untuk menambah fitur keselamatan dan keamanan di jalan, SDP adalah jawabannya.
Fitur yang paling saya sukai adalah pembatalan sein otomatis. Jadi ketika kita menikung, setelah tikungan itu selesai, seinnya akan mati otomatis.
SDP, great!
I'm Chen Minh Ngân, a visitor Net Viet in Hanoi.
I'm Thairat Thongya of Thailand's Thairat TV in Bangkok.
I'm Monica Somborat from the National Television of Cambodia in Phnom Penh.
I'm Raymond Goh of Malaysia's TV Tiga in Kuala Lumpur.
I'm Glenda Chong of Singapore's Channel News Asia.
I'm Sachin Tommy of the Indonesia Channel at the ASEAN Secretariat in Jakarta.
This is your weekly look into the dynamic Southeast Asia region.
ASEAN Today on the Indonesia Channel.
The Best of Bali takes viewers on a special guided tour to the treasures of the Island of the Gods.
Well, the romantic dinner is beautiful.
The Best of Bali, only on the Indonesia Channel.
You're watching Hot Indonesia with Sandrina, Millie, and me. Here's hot topic number two, TUBBY TOTS. It was a trend that began before COVID-19 restrictions kept families at home. A study in the Lancet Science Journal in 2017 projected that if unhealthy eating habits continued, the number of obese children and teenagers would surpass those underweight this year. And experts say the pandemic that kept kids indoors some as long as a year has accelerated that trend. Now, before lockdowns, I saw it, you saw it, obese children following along their parents in the malls. And, you know, I get it. Everyone wants their kids to have the best they can, the best food, enough of it. And then came the coronavirus and then learning at home in front of their screens, no outdoor exercise. Millie, the kilos and the pounds then just started adding up.
Dalton, unfortunately, not only for the kids, but even for adults like myself, you know, what can we do? We are always more nowadays, more indoors and staying in and then watching more TV. Of
course. No, but Millie, you have control over yourself and parents have control over the kids. That is the major difference.
Yes, but I would like to ask Dr. Melanie in this case, do you have tips, practical suggestions?
Yeah, wait, Millie, before we get to the doctor, I want to hear your opinion first on overweight kids. Don't you see it as a problem in Jakarta and other parts of this country?
Yes, but how can we blame them? Because they have to stay indoor. They even do online schooling. So they are in front of the television or computer all the time. And of course, the habit of picking up snacks here, eating anything.
But who's in control of the household? I mean, they don't make their own decisions.
Dalton, kids nowadays, you know, you cannot control them like kids before.
Well, then we blame the parents then.
We blame the parents and parental system and all the system. By the way, it's difficult to control.
I understand, you know. But you've got to do it. That's the job of a parent. Now, of course, not every parent overindulges their children. Sandrina, let me ask you, did you pay extra attention to diet with your teenagers these past 2 years, or are you normally conscientious?
In terms of our daily meals or diet at home, actually there has been no significant changes throughout these last 2 years. Since my daughters were babies, I have always focused on providing healthy meals for them. I have always limited their sugar consumption. For example, when they were small, My children could only have candies on Sundays. We call it Candy Day, so it becomes special. If they are, for example, given candies by their friends at the birthday party or at school, then they would have to save it until Sunday comes. I never introduced soda or carbonated drinks to my children, so they grew up not being a fan of such drinks. They don't have a sweet tooth. Another example, even until now, they can only eat 2 portions of instant noodles per month. So practically, we eat healthy food all year long, of course.
Wow, you're a strict mom. Yeah,
No, but what we cheat once in a while, of course.
And you did you do it out of love. I mean, and that's the point, yeah?
Okay. But we provide good food. Sometimes we have fast food.
Not questioning
food.
That. Yeah. Let's get the expert input now. Dr. Melanie Iskandar is a pediatrician at Bunda Hospital in Jakarta. Doctor, thank you very much for joining us. Now, the study I mentioned was a global one. Can you confirm for us that the problem of childhood obesity is significant here?
Well, it happens during this pandemic. Some of my patients that already not come visit me so often, and they came bringing their newborn sister or brother, and it was shock. They're like, oh my God, you're so big now. Usually parents kind of having a struggle during the first 2 years their babies to gain weight, you know, so many with feeding problems and everything. But then came back again to my practice after maybe 5 or 7 years and looked so big because, I think the obesity problem really affected the adolescent and teenager. But you have to remember, we cannot do strict diet like adult, okay? Because children still growing. They still need carbs. They still need protein and fat. So yeah, maybe
a balance and volume, right? Volume is the key too.
Lessen the portion and then maybe doing scheduling, you know.
And ladies, I don't want to make light of the economic levels in this country. This essentially right now, anyway, is kind of a middle class and upper class problem. Whereas the others, you know, still have a problem of getting proper nutrition. Millie, now you can ask your question directly to Dr. Iskandar.
Yes, doctor. I would like to ask actually, what are the practical solutions so that, because I have an adult daughter, but how should I suggest to her to maintain, a certain body weight, ideal body weight, of course. And what if talking to smaller children, for example, some of them are defiant, you know, we can say less sugar, no soda, no Indomie, and they'll say, no, I want them. You know, what should we do? You know, how do we manage this?
Parents is the example of their children. So what you have to do not provide it at home. Don't have instant noodle at home, or don't buy sweet treats in the supermarket. As you know, body weight, that's the result of balancing your calorie intake and output. So before I set the portion, the calorie and everything, cut the sugar, more water intake, and then doing more move your body. For children, we suggest that every day you move 1 to 2 hours a day for adolescents and teenagers.
So, but how do you move during a pandemic?
You do your house chores, you can do that, and then you can follow YouTube, maybe doing exercise with your parents or with your mother, or you can take like online classes. Like my son used to take futsal online, so they learned the technique. And then my daughter also joined a ballet class online.
Okay. So if you have to stay in front of a screen, use that to your advantage. Sandrina, question for doctor, please.
Doc, I was told that one of the main causes of child obesity in Indonesia is actually the countless types of formula milk consumed by so many Indonesian children since a very early age. Because to boost sales here in Indonesia, the sugar content are at levels way higher than it should be. Is this true? And aside from sugar, what is actually the most dangerous substance that causes child obesity?
Yes. Well, that's why we press, we make sure that all our babies get breast milk for the first 6 months and then continue the breastfeeding, mother giving breastfeeding until 2 years old. That really avoid obesity. And for the formula, we always make sure we give education to parents, like between 6 to 12 months, they need to lower the formula intake, the milk intake, because they need to learn how to eat solid food. And then after 12 months, they cannot consume more than 500 ml milk. Okay, we make sure that. So that's what we always do as a pediatrician to educate the parents. And then sugar is the worst. You know, you can get it from snacks, soft drinks, and all those junk foods. So I think, yes, sugar is the worst.
Okay, yeah, I mean, I don't think parents are giving a one-year-old soda or chocolate bars. And you made a good point earlier, Doctor, to wrap this up, is balance. And we're not talking about cutting out sugar or carbs, because those are essential in having a kid grow up properly, but just limiting the intake. And as they get older, then you can watch what they eat. And that's the job of the parent. Dr. Melanie Iskandar, thank you very much for your time and expertise. More hot Indo is ahead. High stakes. This expensive beef being served up, the latest dining trend next.
Welcome to Yoga Bliss. Exhale, reaching down to triangle pose. Roll your knee out and up to the sky, breathing here.
Yoga Bliss, only on the Indonesia Channel.
And you are watching
iPop Playlist. Kau datang di hidupku. Terus berlari.
We play Indonesia's best music videos. Kau goreskan warna baru.
Channel.
You are watching Hot Indonesia from Jakarta. Hot topic number 3, high stakes. Now, you ask a friend out to dinner here in Jakarta, and chances are when the waiter comes, the order will be steak. And that's because it's not consumed very often at home due to price and availability. So more and more high-end steakhouses have been opening to cater to the taste for meat, with prices ranging from $70 to $200 a cut, and sometimes more. The latest entry, ladies, is called Meatsmith in the Senopati district. All the restaurants there with wood-fired steaks, brisket, and burgers already here. As you know, Roots Chris Steakhouse, Wolfgang Steakhouse, and others. Sandrina, if I want a good steak, I will definitely pay the price for it.
I believe you would, Dalton. Most meat lovers or steak lovers would pay the price for a good steak. My daughter, for example, loves to eat steak and would be really excited if she reads good reviews about a new steakhouse, and she would certainly want to go there and try the best steak on the menu. But for me personally, this topic is quite irrelevant. As you know, I don't eat red meat. It's just a matter of personal preference. Since I was a kid, I never liked red meat. And since high school, I just stopped completely from consuming red meat. And apparently, health-wise, not eating red meat is better for our body. So unless this steakhouse serves chicken steak, then you will not see me dining there. If I do go there, then it will be because I'm accompanying my family or invited by friends, and I will end up eating a bowl of salad and go straight to dessert.
This is a chicken country. Yes, I understand that. And they always say McDonald's serves more chicken than burgers, which is, I don't believe it, but that's what they always say. You know, there are also middle-class steak joints here, such as the chain Holy Cow with so-called local Wagyu for under $10. Millie, for perspective, growing up here, beef was kind of a luxury, right?
Yes. But I'm with Sandrina. You know, the last time I ate steak was probably 20 years ago. And I don't miss it. I don't miss it at all. And in fact, I prefer vegetarian food more than anything else, Dalton. So I'm sorry, I'm not with you here.
This is the wrong team I talk about steaks, then. I mean, oh, man.
Yes.
Well, if you want advice, talk to me. I'll tell you where to go, which one of the ones I mentioned. I mean,
we will not ask for your advice.
Oh, come on. If you want real good steak, I can tell you. That's the point.
Chicken steak.
Then you go to this place where I know.
It's healthier. Lamb.
All right. I got your point, but we're talking about steak houses opening up. It is feedback time now. On the YouTube page of our partner TV1, Ray reacted to the Java man who symbolically married his rice cooker. Marriage is not a joke. I agree. But CL said this, as long as he's happy and his rice isn't overcooked. Here's how to contact us with your feedback. Email at hotindo@theindonesiachannel.com or comment through our Hot Indonesia or Indonesia Channel Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube pages. Final words, Miss Sandrina.
Lately, it has been raining almost daily, and I have been receiving news from friends that now, aside from COVID, we must also be aware that the number of dengue cases is rising. Several of my friends are either still bedridden or have just recovered from dengue fever. So make sure that there are no stagnant water-containing objects around your house or workplace. Check your flower pots, water ponds, water drains, even your water dispensers spillover container. Clean them frequently and use mosquito repellents when you are doing outdoor activities. The weather has been quite extreme in so many places, so please take care, stay healthy, stay safe.
And speaking of dengue, we will have a dengue prevention special on TIC on February 2nd with host Karina Tasha, so look for that. Final words, Millie.
I just got myself a booster 2 days ago, a Pfizer booster. And right after the booster, I was informed that Sinopharm is now currently developing a special vaccine for Omicron, especially targeting the Omicron. So I thought to myself, how many times do we have to do this? You know, help, please.
Good point. Good point, Millie. And my final words, you know, speaking of COVID, the number of new COVID-19 cases here rose past 1,000 this past week for the first time in months. The Omicron variant is the reason why, but the government says no one has died from it yet, at least of this taping. Meaning, yes, it's spreading again, the virus is, but it's not causing serious illness. So if you feel sick, like I did last week, get a test, then stay at home because chances are good that you'll recover and then move along from that sickness. And that is Hot Indonesia for this week. For Sanjila Malikiano and Millie Lukito, I'm Dalton Tanonaka. Thank you very much for watching. Please join us again next time.